The views expressed on this show do not represent those of NTV or its staff.
This is NTV People's Parliament sitting here in Gulu District, discussing issues that affect the people of Gulu District and the Northern Uganda as large. Last week, we could not exhaust the topic of post-war recovery, transformation and development. So we shall continue from where we stopped. Honorable Member, we discussed the issues of post-war recovery, development and transformation. So we want the people to hear from you. What do you think government should do to ensure that the Northern Uganda is completely transformed from the conflict?
Thank you so much, Madam Speaker. Atimbete are my names. Madam Speaker, I feel it would be so good when the government reduced the issue of red tape in the accessibility of these projects within the program which are being implemented here. Because, for example, when I said accessing the livelihood, youth livelihood program, you find that the age limit is also limit. The number of the groups that they should access the project also is limit. So there's need to see that the red tape in the accessibility of these programs are. The second one is supervision of this program being implemented, especially the projects within the programs. Because when it is being implemented from the center, it is not all that so easy for those who are the beneficiary here. Because at times even
you mean the youth are not accessing
the red tape.
The funds here in Northern Uganda?
The red tape. They are accessing, but the red tape, because the age limit is there, the number of groups that they should access from parish is also there. So there's a lot of loopholes in accessing the program. The supervision, as I said, should also be lowered down here to the people who are the beneficiary from here, not from the center. The ownership of these programs, let me say you come and impose a program on somebody without asking what do you think can be good for you. It will not be so much implementable, because I will not own it as it is for my benefit, because maybe I didn't even have any interest in carrying out such a project. And also, I was looking also at adherence to the program time frame, because at times they can say we are opening a road, but you find that because since the project is from the center, the people who are supposed to supervise and monitor they are from the center, it takes so long. I can cite one example. Look at Kamdini Gulu Road, where it is now. It has taken even, it is even, the time frame for the project is almost elapsing. So this is what I have.
Thank you, Honorable Member. Yes, Honorable Member holding the podium. What are your issues in terms of recovery in this region?
One thing that really touches my heart, that I feel so pity whenever I move places, is that the effect of the war, the post-war, effect has affected our people mentally. We have lots of people who are mentally derailed as I talk now. If you go to Gulu Referral Regional Hospital, the mental unit, it's pathetic. You don't want to be there. Those are the few that have been brought for help. What about the ones that are back in the deep, in the villages, back at home? I've been moving places. You find people are talking to themselves. Ask me why. Ask yourself, why is somebody talking to him? To
they have been
himself?
Mentally affected.
Yes, they have. These people, probably some of them have seen the people being killed, dying in the presence of their own relatives. I mean, the relatives being killed in their presence, it has traumatized them. People are fully traumatized. We need counselors, just like one of my sister got up and said, we need people right here who speak the language, I can open up to you. I want to believe that every one of us has been affected with this war. So we need people who can have a one-on-one with us, with the local dialogue, so that we get a healing. We get a healing from the post-war trauma. And then another thing is that the women. Okay, of course, normally the war affects mostly women and the children. The women are so much affected. We have a program here called Living Hope. It's part of our Toto Church program. Very few women have been able to access that. They have been rehabilitated in the society. They have been empowered with livelihood, self-livelihood. They make lots of stuff that they can sell that gives them money. What about the women back in the grassroots, in the village? That program has not reached them. How are they coping up? It's really painful.
Thank you, Anaromba. Is there an NGO that are working towards the traumatizing of the people who have been... Yes, World Division, what are you doing in that field?
Madam Speaker, the Children of War Rehabilitation Program is open to date. Every person that has been in captivity pass through the center and stay in the center for not less than 3 months before reuniting them with their families. World Vision is continuing to follow up every person that has passed through
the
center.
What about those people who did not come through the right channels?
Up to now, as I speak, we have counselors who are in the center, and unfortunately we cannot reach out to everybody, and that is the constraint of development organization. We have few counselors on ground, and these counselors cannot reach out to everyone. The chairperson has made mention that Gulu district is constrained. A number of development partners that were handling psychosocial programming have all phased out, and that is the appeal of the district. Most of the development partners that were handling concurrently with World Vision has phased out, and the organization is overwhelmed, and that is the outcry all over. My sister is very right that in as much as the need is there, we do not have enough human resource even at the Gulu referral center to handle such cases.
Thank you. Yes, honorable member.
When NGOs left, those people, and then people started returning to their home states, distance began. Because I could be in Camp A, he's also in Camp A, she's also in Camp A, but during return, that one goes to Amuru, the other one goes to Nwoya, and I remain in Gulu. So the structure got demoralized. That one is one. But now for people who came through other ways, not directly, we have three ways at which people come: through UPDF, through religious leaders and other community members, and some people sneak in. Now, when handling psychosocial support, at the moment, what is happening is 80% of people who come from captivity is normally integrated among 20% of people who never went to the bush.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I think you have heard for yourself, government. The psychosocial support programs are actually needed in northern Uganda here. When I went to Agago district, actually, there are very many people who are traumatized, and these people actually are very violent. They need to be counseled. Yes, honorable member, what is your burning issue that you can summarize in 1 minute?
Madam Speaker and honorable members present, my name is Geoffrey Udong, and you can call me Ojibu. My concern about the recovery for Northern Uganda is specifically on the skill training of our young people.
Speak to the people, please.
We have seen government sending money for skill development, but we have not seen government instituting programs that would absorb these people who have got the skill. My proposal would be if government would bring a project that would employ and absorb those who had got the skill training. Two, we had seen payment for this actually wood death claimant for the animal. My proposal would be, why can't we use approaches that were used in other countries, like giving money to households directly instead of having association, money is getting lost and everything. So I believe if we pay money directly to the individual's account, and I would also think that if we use local government, that money that comes from the government should come to local government, from local government to individuals' account. That will solve the problem of corruption.
We have seen a lot of
money being squandered by people in quotes. They call them ordered from above. We have been ordered from wherever.
Thank
we
you.
Don't have an above. All of
Thank
us
you.
Are the same.
Thank you, honorable member. Yes, yes. You are an elder and you should have a lot of information about this.
Madam Speaker and honorable members here present, thank you for giving me the opportunity. The impression I've got from all these interactions are to the effect that 8 years down the road since the war ended, there has not been a lot done to change the lives of the people at community level. That is the impression which I've got. And yet, during the same period, a lot of development partners, a lot of government programs, and even the private sector have been engaged in the post-conflict recovery, transformation, and development.
Information, Madam Speaker?
Not accepted. Two of all the programs which were delivered here, I am sure if we are to ask those people whom we claim we have been working with, have their capacity been built? Where capacity building or giving them capacity is giving them ability to perform functions, solve their problems, meet their objectives. Is it there? And if it is there, why is it that those changes are not forthcoming? I want to conclude by giving this proposal. Three proposals. One, the package through which these development programs have come, PRDP, was well intended. I think, in my view, it was well intended. And then PRDP has to be delivered through a vehicle, and that vehicle is the local government decentralized system of government. But if I'm to ask, how many of those who have been working in the field of development have been consciously discharging their duties as partners to local government in development? How many of such program development partners have been carrying on their programs, playing their cards on their chest?
Thank you.
Therefore, to conclude, the government should strengthen capacity of local government to monitor all the development programs. If at all these have to bear fruit.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Honorable Member. Thank you, Honorable Member. In just 1 minute, what is your burning issue before we go to the...
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I really came up here on one issue which is quite burning me, and I cannot keep it within me. Much as we are speaking about the issue of this prevailing peace, which is existing within us, there are some people, I would like to tell you, the Honorable Speaker, that there are some people who are crying seriously since much as the peace is prevailing. Because there are people who have lost business because the war has ended and they are not up about the peace. That is one. There are people who have lost their jobs and they are not able to perform any task at the moment and they are crying seriously. So my issue, as we are discussing the issue of recovery programs, there are very many NGOs or body sets to monitor such programs. But my issue is, one, the government has given open door for NGOs to come and support the people in Northern Uganda who has been greatly affected. But most of these NGO, Madam Speaker, are for their stomachs and their families. I would like to stand by this because on a small case...
What information do you want to give? Just a moment. Are you coming from an NGO? Are you from an NGO? Are you working for your stomachs? Please. Please, be straight. Speak straight.
Madam Speaker, I think when honorable members are coming to the floor, they need to come with informed decisions and with facts. I would like to say if the chairperson was here, he would tell you, if you look at the district budget, you would see in the different sectors how much NGOs have been contributing. I would say in Gulu district, in the PRDP, NGOs have been contributing over 80% to the district budget. So
thank
I don't
you.
Know where you're getting that information from.
Thank you. Please,
thank you.
Can you speak from a point of information and really appreciate what
point,
these people have done?
For that point of information, I'm speaking this for a case of point. I'll say, in some NGOs, you find that a driver is getting 1 million shillings.
Sorry. Thank you. Let's go for a short break. And when we come back, we are going to discuss issues of of compensation and development programs, what has gone wrong. As you are aware, there are very many programs that government want to bring in northern Uganda here, but the communities are resisting them. We want to know why these communities are resisting these development projects. Welcome back. You are still watching NTV People's Parliament, sitting here in Gul District at the district headquarters. And the issue at hand is the post-war recovery, transformation, and development. But as these people talk about recovery, you have heard from people, they have complained about the compensation of the lives that were lost, the livestock that was lost. And I want to hear from the people. Haven't people been compensated? As you are aware, Honorable Member, about 5 billion shillings was earmarked by government to compensate the war claimants. What has gone wrong, without accusing names, without accusing people? What has gone wrong? Yes, Honorable Member.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, fellow Member of Parliament. Madam Speaker, our local people or the LRA war victims were not properly compensated. The money that was given, it was going to the wrong people. And as I speak now, there is an empty promise the government made to the local people, especially when former Minister for Portfolio, Richard Odong, is still presidential advisor for Northern Uganda. The people were registering under his office that there will be compensating the LRA war victim, but still up to now, people have not yet get anything from the government. Secondly, Madam Speaker, I want to raise something briefly on the issue of justice and the reconciliation in Northern Uganda. You know, when these people are coming from the bush, there was this issue of amnesty commissioner. When our MPs present this motion to the floor of the parliament, they passed this bill that there should be given the amnesty. But as I speak now, the amnesty was given to some people like Kamdulu, Banya, but others were denying given amnesty. Like Kwoyere, speak now. Kwoyere is under the custody of the government. When will the government of Uganda grant amnesty to Kwoyere? This is now the key question that we should ask as we the poor people of Northern Uganda. Because we know at the first place, other children, other people are still in the bush. If we block this amnesty commissioner to grant amnesty to these people, then they may not even come back again to this usual life.
Could advise ourselves to make sure that we don't be corrupt, because corruption has been one of the major cause of the what? Of the misimplementation of these things. You know, it's major. And the answer is because we don't fear God. So I would advise anybody who would like to be somebody to first fear God, because the beginning of wisdom is to fear God. So we have been having a lot of corrupted people with corrupted actions. That's why we don't see all these things. So also, I would appreciate so much what the government has done over the years, because the government is so serious always to do things which is positive. But the people, between the highest authority in the government, the president, and the grassroots, we have a lot of rotten people around. They're so rotten, and they bring many other things to make people think that we are not really serious doing things.
Thank you, Honorable Member. Yes, Honorable Member holding the bottom. You're addressing issues of compensation and development. What do you think has gone wrong in area of compensating the war claimants? People who lost their livestock.
Yes, Madam Speaker, Honorable. First of all, I would like to appreciate the people of Parliament at this particular juncture. As far as recovery program compensation is concerned, for the cattle or animals, so far they have not been compensated. We find a person only maybe 400 cattle being given only 100,000 or 200,000. And this has caused a lot of societal tendency where a museum has gone come from the village after receiving maybe 100,000 instead of some billions, good amount of money, he fell and then consciously passed away. So therefore, there is need still that when the government wants this to act, because through the traumatic events we are having healing wound, which has not been recovered. As far as Ghana is silent, but there is that Cold War whereby people are still violent. Therefore, there is need for our people to maybe give opinion towards their property which has been taken during war.
What is your burning issue, Honorable Member?
I am one of those who lost a lot of cows during the insurgency. almost 185 cows. What do I want to be done? Very simple. This is a crime. It cannot be negotiated. It's a crime. This is government money. It must be accounted for. There's no way the government is going to release money unless there is accountability. Therefore, in short, let us get this fellas investigated. And my only problem is that we have investigation systems which are a little bit not working so well. The police would have taken this, the IGG, so that we have a file, fellas arrested, taken, prosecuted, and the government released for us the money. That's all we can do.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Member. Please, can you take up the podium? We have been having a very burning issue. You have the floor, Honorable Member.
Madam Speaker, my name is Honorable Jackson Odong for civil society, particularly Refugee Law Project. There is a lot, but I'll just submit on three things. One, earlier you asked a question, what went wrong with the various development programs that came in the region? And I want to say something about PRDP. That one, at the moment, the recovery needs actually outweigh the registered achievements. Why? Because PRDP 1, when it came, actually was everywhere. And because PRDP was everywhere, what locals told us when we were doing a survey some time back was that it was thrown along the way, which meant that some people made good use of it. Some people, actually part of it, on the other hand, was eaten and stolen. And now we are thinking, what do we do going forward? And I want to suggest three things. That one, while it was earlier suggested that we need a successor program for PRDP, one of the reasons why we have been having so many programs is because we have been working on more of a fire brigade approach. Anybody thinks of an activity and it is modeled into a program, and then we don't think deeper on what it means for reconstruction. What we have been doing, in essence, was more of relief, trying to stabilize the area, like fighting a fire. Now the fire is gone. When we talk about peace, we are talking beyond the guns falling silent. And that means financial security, that means skilling the youth, that means that people should be empowered to be able to make life, have some livelihoods. So this is not only a government thing, it's not a civil society thing, it also involves the people. One of the issues is that the role of the media has not been discussed here, but it had a role to play in the recovery process. And our leaders have exploited the media to the advantage of them and not to the people. People in northern Uganda listen to radio, for example, and they trust information coming from radio as gospel truth. But what is it that we, the leaders, speak on radio about recovery? If we can begin to change our approach of sensitizing community, that is one way going forward. The other one is, there should be some kind of social entrepreneurship. We are talking about children, the street children. Even if they are these structures, we need people, for example, to cook for these children. And these people will come from the community. So we need initiatives that would target more of social entrepreneurship to have homeless centers. And lastly, the issue of community solidarity. We need to begin talking as one voice, as community, and begin to face our leaders. If we have this program, in fact, one of the things that needs to change is that the name should not be called PRDP3, as many people want to advocate for it. Because PRDP itself has had a bad taint, and it will not change in the mindset of people who still need counseling. Okay. So can we come up with a new name and enshrine it with a more comprehensive agenda, including comprehensive reparation program? Mm. And to add on the last discussion that we were talking about compensation, we had had Lira Wardes Clemens, Teso Wardes Clemens, and Acholi Wardes Clemens. But most of this discussion has been reduced to cattle. And yet compensation should actually go beyond the cattle. So we should have a full framework to deal with these things. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Honorable Member. Let's go for a short break, and when we come back, we are going to discuss issues of development. What can we do? What should government do to develop Northern Uganda in terms of land utilization and other natural resources? Welcome back. You are still watching NTV People's Parliament, sitting here in Gulu District, discussing issues that affect the common person here. Nobody can give you such an opportunity, but with NTV, you have the opportunity to air out your issues. So there is no need for demonstration. There is no need for hanging yourself. Just come to People's Parliament and air out issues that affect you, or forever you keep quiet. Yes, we are still discussing the issue of development in Northern Uganda as we want to recover from war. But we are wondering, some projects are being resisted. Talk about the project in Amuru. There is a company that wants to set up a very big project here for people to get jobs. But why are people resisting development?
Most of the people who were affected with the war are now going back to prostitution. Now, if we see, we are leaving those people who are going for prostitution, and now we are focusing only to the people who are in the community. Now we have to come with a program that can even capture those people so that they start coming to a normal life. And if we are to see, not only prostitution, but those people who were coming back from the war, they are now poor and they cannot even afford to eat other people. So we have to come with a new program that can make them to earn a living, like a tailoring and many other things, so
thank
that
you.
They can be constructive
member,
to our...
Thank you. We want to wind up, but we want to give each 1 minute to bring up a solution, a development solution for this region. Yes, Honorable
thank
Member,
you.
Holding the
thank
podium.
Thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. All these projects that were proposed and implemented by the government were very good, but the sustainability part of it was left. Look at the buildings that were built by PRDP projects. Is the government taking precautions or taking steps on renovating those classroom blocks, or taking care of maintenance of those roads, maintenance of the latrine system, maintenance of the court system that have been brought down to the grassroots level, looking at the redistribution of the works of the police? Is the government taking care of the sustainability of these outposts that have been brought down there? These are all not taking place. So I feel for development, sustainable development to continue in Uganda, whatever policies the government or any other civil society organization is bringing on board to help rebuild Northern Uganda to its former state should have a sustainability foundation, because without a foundation, we cannot see the height. The deeper the foundation, the better the height of the building. Thank you.
Thank you, Honorable Member. Yes, the lady holding the floor.
Thank you very much.
Which development issues should we focus on to recover completely and regain ourselves economically?
Thank you, Honorable Speaker, and all protocol observed. My name is Aya Cynthia, and I work with Human Rights Focus. Human Rights Focus does a lot with information sharing and legal assistance. One thing that we have found out is that when trying to implement development activities, we are not developing it, implementing it using a holistic approach. First of all, you must know, fine, the guns have silenced, but what we have is a conflict transformation. And if we don't look at it, if we keep thinking we are at peace, it is not peace. It's just the conflict transformed to some of the land conflicts, to gender-based violence, to domestic violence. And it's on the increase in Northern Uganda. So we need a holistic approach whereby I'm not even sure if people know there is a draft policy on transitional justice. And I'm not also sure if people know there is a bill on transitional justice. For instance, a good example is that when we are going to do this information sharing, especially on the laws and policies of Uganda, down at the grassroots, most of the times the community is shocked. How often has the government or different structures informed the community members down there? So it needs also us to share some of this information, especially us as leaders, those in positions that can at least inform the population so that they can contribute their points of view. A number of views have been presented here, but I don't think they are going to be added into the policy, the draft policy of the transitional justice. I'm not sure if they're going to be added into the bill for the transitional
justice. The powers that be will hear your resolution is, and they will actually insert them in. Yes, Honourable Member, what should we do as a region, and how should government help us? Yes.
Thank you, Right Honourable Speaker of the People's Parliament. My name is Simon Zedema. In this capacity, I'm speaking as a Ugandan because I'm not an Acholi, but I've been living here for some time.
You are staying in Acholi.
I want to go right to my point and clearly say that there has been a lot in the short time I was living here that I observed. People have been traumatized, as all the honorable members put it. There's been a lot of suffering, there's a lot of trauma, the post-war recovery effects are too much to mention, but a few. Now, in my suggestion, government, this is my appeal now to government first, then I will come and appeal to the local people. Government should not consider the issue of equitable distribution of resources region-wise. It should at least give something, as the Honorable Reagan Okumu put it, something more to the north, just because it has to cover the other gap that was actually occurred during the war. Because if you give people the same resources or the same amount of money to rebuild or to build them from whatever trauma they have gone through, it will not work in the north. First of all, here, the people who are not farming, people who are not doing a lot of work in the farms, that would bring economic dependence. The people of northern Uganda, we should actually be ourselves the watchdogs. Let us watch out and see that whichever money is brought to help rebuild the north because of the war, it has been put to right use.
Thank you.
The billions that were sent here for the war debt claimants, about 9 billion plus has been mismanaged. The top bosses in the association have been able to pay themselves.
What are the development issues you think should be implemented to recover this region?
In the whole house at large, I'm going to be very mean with my 1 minute, and I think I will air out just one issue. Because thinking of developing a community that has been malnourished for about 20 years is something very broad. We cannot come out with a resolution in the mere few seconds given. But one issue is that we are blessed with a lot of resources. We have the lands. I mean, we have the land. We have various sites that can attract tourists into our community. If only the government could partner with our local community to bring out private investors who could invest in those land to benefit both the government and the local community, it would be a very crucial and very important thing.
But there are people who
thing.
Are resisting these developments because they think government is
it
grabbing
is
their
because,
land.
It is because of the terms and conditions that are given. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Honourable Member.
Thank you very much.
Yes, you have a burning issue, Honourable Member.
Lueng me Uganda and in Uguru Kumo one wang pitting our mama pelueng Uguru Kume.
All of us were affected with this war.
Mege maka and in a wang in on a Jomo Kennedy Manadong Timon Ta, Jomo Kennedy Manadong Mongi Bana Pere, when Lueng me Uganda and Okelo.
Some of us have remained widows and widowers.
I know ni Jomo Kennedy Tier Danaman or Waroketi and Gimacom Giot. Eto kumbetini nuti yene ngono, bede ngono, wala, doge ki ngono.
Some of us were able people, but this time we have remained disabled.
Do alego gamete kachul, ano netiema gamene bakate kichul, miyargune ankate gul weng.
I request the government to look into the competition of some of us.
Kene arma marjimi nemo kene tiema ki wekolo gara da chen.
In many cases, the disabled people are ignored.
Ane na bedo kan fit pe a winyo ngaro mama la la kom e kom dana ma chunga ene ma kom giyata pe gila la ma ki karo la garke gipinga.
Since I sat here, nobody has ever talked about the disabled.
So was she disabled because of the war?
Ikara milwen enini wanwa na wanu maduong. Am enini metika nana enini. Uno bena pati kita eni tutuad. Eto en perami awano enone. Enwe ona atikete. Kidong.
I was affected during the war.
Kidong lega na beti kita eni. Nilongalo wen miarke kergi ubed bena. Ikin project ma ke kan ma ke tiga meta gamenta miar uchuli ye chuda.
I request all the disabled people to be at least programmed in a project.
Thank you. Thank you. Actually, her request is that those people who are disabled because of war should get a program to rehabilitate them and probably to compensate them. Honorable member, can you, 1 minute, people are talking about development issues, bringing in private partners to partner with the local people to bring in development projects in this region. But the locals are resisting these development projects because they claim their land is being grabbed. How do you think this is going to be addressed in 1 minute?
Yes. Thank you, Honorable Speaker. One thing is that we have land policy, we have land law. In case we want to use land, like for example, that one of Amuru, with the intention of creating jobs to the people, it is important to follow the right procedure, the right channel. It has not been followed. It was supposed to be land grabbing, that one of Amuru, and it was supposed to be, you know, a project is there and people are there. It was not pro people. We saw
so
it
what
in
do you
the
think should be done?
It's
for people to accept
we say
that
for
project.
People, it is important that it has to be pro people. People must be consulted. If government wants land, you see, we had the BAT, that is British Americans Tobacco. When they came, they did not grab land. We even told the Amuru project that if you want, ask for maybe 1,000 acres of land. Put your machinery, put your what? Is it accommodation for your staff? But make sure that it is the people who actually cultivate this sugar. You should not grab land away from people. But they say, no, 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 no. Then we say, if you say, no, 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 to hell with your project. Your project is not pro-people. It is actually grabbing away land from people and making people become landless and they become squatters on their own land.
Thank
this
you.
Is not right.
Thank you, Honourable Member. Yes. What? How do you think we should develop this region?
Yes.
As we forget the wounds of war.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. You know, we still have land and we can really make good use of the land. If only the government can give us the input, give us the tractor at a lower rate, we shall dig our land. And you know, we always produce maize, we produce rice, but we don't have the capacity of making it in large numbers. But if we are given the tractors, I think we can do it.
Yes.
And also, we need the banks which will come and help us. Let the bank reduce the interest. Let the interest be reduced so that we are able to take the loans, buy the tractor ourselves, and begin to make good use of our land. So that we are able to farm in a large number.
Thank you, Honorable Member. Just, we want now, we are winding up with 1 minute. What are your suggestions in order for us to forget the wounds of war and recover economically?
Thank you, Honorable Speaker. I have only one burning issue. One is that information strengthening. We are all talking about government giving money and giving in the equipment for farming. But to what extent are our youth are informed, those ones who are born in the camp, to what extent are they informed that when they go and dig and invest in their land, they can do something? We are born in the IDP camps, and we were, for the rest of the 20 years, we have been there in the camp, not farming, not digging, just roaming around. So do you think from now we can pick from in a year to go and start digging in the garden? No, it will not happen.
Thank you.
So first of all, we have to be, the mindset of people have to be driven towards the development.
Thank you, Honorable Member, your time is out. In terms of education, for us to develop, actually, we need to invest much in education. What do you think should be done in the education sector? Can I have one expert to give me some information of what should be done in the education sector?
personally have observed very keenly the reasons as to why the standards of education has deteriorated so much in northern Uganda. One, I would like first of all to suggest that if possible, teachers should be given a chance to go for further training. I'm seeing a situation where our teachers are not in position to teach the children in the standard that can uplift their standard. Most of the teachers do not believe that they are substandard, but I want to assure you that I've done my survey, I've been to schools, I've seen what is going on. The teachers are not delivering in the way that empowers the children to learn, and there is need for the teachers to be empowered.
For so long, we were not having statistics on persons with disabilities, and for now, I believe with the preliminary result of the census, about 16% of population is PWDs. And for instance, in Gulu district here, in Acholi region, there is no school for special need for people with hearing impairment. So it is an urgent call that the government should establish a secondary school for the hearing impairment. And also special needs should go into the rural. Like in the district here, we don't have special needs school for people who need special attention. It's only within the municipality. So we need that urgently. And we need also vocational skill development for those who have not got opportunity to acquire the education at an earlier age. And lastly, Madam Speaker, we were talking about compensation. Most people talked of property and other things. There are people who are maimed. I know some people who have only one limb. Both leg and the arms are not there. Government should take care of those people as a priority because they are living and they need to really earn their livelihood. They have children, they have family to cater for them. Thank you.
Thank you, Honourable Member. Please, in 1 minute, can you wind up your resolution?
Education. To solve this problem of education, we have to do affirmative action for the short term. Then the other suggestions which people gave are long term. Short term is to give quotas for all courses, to give quotas for the Acholi region, sub-region, that this is maybe 15% of all admissions should go to the Acholis. Whether somebody has got low marks, provided he has two principal passes and you are an Acholi, you compete for those quotas, then the others can compete for the remaining things. So we should advocate for the quotas.
Thank you.
Then,
please wind up in half a minute.
In winding up, this thing of saying that we should empower teachers and what, that one can help. But also, you remember the UNEP secretary himself said that the examinations do not test the people, do not test the people's potential and ability fully. So you can do all those, but then the examination should be transformed to cater for somebody who has not seen electricity in what? In a deep in the village. That exam should be special for him. You cannot ask the issue of electricity to somebody in Amur and the same electricity.
Thank you, Honourable Member. We have time constraints. The topic of post-war recovery, transformation and development is a very wide issue that we cannot exhaust now. You have heard for yourself the voices from northern Uganda. People who were born in camps have not accessed quality education. There is need for vocational training for them to be able to get jobs. There are places that need development. The people of northern Uganda need development partners, private people, to partner with the people in order to bring development in this particular region such that people can forget the wounds of war and completely recover to move on developing this country. I'm still Agnes Nandutu, the Speaker of People's Parliament. I adjourn this house. Until next time.
The views expressed on this show do not represent those of NTV or its staff.